drawback claimants, and claimants are usually the parties which are entitled to claim the drawback. And keep in mind there are various players, and by the time the product is exported, it went through the importer, it usually went through the manufacturer or some kind of merchandiser that sells and buys products and ships them overseas, and it went through the transportation of companies, intermediaries, middlemen, middlewomen, middle persons, and so even though one party may wear the same hat, you still must be mindful that there are different players involved. And because there are different players involved, you have to know who has a basic right to claim the drawback. So the starting point is to understand that the exporting party, the party who exports the product, is not the only party that can make that claim. It is also the party that destroys the product. Remember, the product does not have to be only exported. And I think when we spoke about the rejected merchandise drawback, we mentioned that part, that the product can also be destroyed to qualify for the refund of duties. So, this may make sense, but sometimes you may not be able to export the stuff altogether because there is some kind of legal requirements. Let's say the product has been deemed as not safe. So you may not be able to export it out, or at least legally speaking, because it doesn't comply with various safety requirements. But you already brought it in and you paid the duty for, so it may not be a good idea for you to export it to other places. It may be just easier for you to destroy it and avoid those penalties as a part of agreement with various agencies such as Consumer Product Safety Commission, for example. And this is a real thing. If those of you who go to the department stores like Walmart, let's say, will see that there is a board, and there is always some kind of recall notices out there, and those recall notices relate to the safety requirements. And what happens to those products, right? I have seen some of those products destroyed because in part of the safety issues. So this stuff happens. All right, now. So let's take a look at the players. So we have several players. The chart specifies, goes by the type, manufacturing, unused, and rejected, and goes by the player, right? So you have exporter, destroyer, manufacturer, producer, intermediate party, and importer, right? The default is for any type of drawback, exporter and destroyer are the parties that are entitled to claim the drawback automatically. All the other parties, so the gray shaded area means not applicable. All the other parties can be entitled to claim the drawback, but they have to get the assignment rights. All right, they have to get the assignment rights, and because of that, there is documentation requires that shows the demonstration. Remember that certificate of manufacturing and delivery that I was talking about, which is no longer a requirement. So documentation must show the chain of custody, the transfer of title, and the right to an ability for the party who claims the drawback to be able to show the eligibility for the monies that the exporter or the destroyer has assigned to that particular party. All right, now, so importer is a default yes for the rejected merchandise drawback, and the reason for the rejected merchandise drawback is because it's usually the importing party who comes in and and remember we talked about that sample specification requirement where you got the smiley face but it was upside down. So picking off of that example, it's not going to, the importer will usually be aggrieved party, and the importer will usually be the party who says, okay, I don't want this stuff, I'm shipping it back. So you importer, given the specificity of this rejected merchandise drawback situation, the importer would be usually the one that is also the acting as an exporter. In other cases, such as the manufacturing drawback, it would be the other way around. It would not be usually the importer, because the importer and manufacturer, although sometimes are the same, they are usually different parties. So let's see. So keeping those defaults in mind, let's take a look at some of the examples. So company ABC imported shoes from Italy in June 2011. Company ABC sells the shoes to company 123 located in the US. Company 123 exports shoes to Germany. What must company ABC do to obtain to claim merchandise drawback? All right. So let's have a little picture of what's going on. So ABC brought the stuff in the United States. So this is the United States. In the United States, 123 was sold to 123, and 123 sends the stuff to Germany. So the ISO code for Germany is DE. And so here the default party is the exporter, right? What must company ABC do in order to obtain? So notice, ABC is the importer, right? 123 is the exporter. So it would be 123 who is automatically eligible by default because it's the exporter or destroyer. Going back to the chart, right? Exporter or destroyer. The importer, however, required to provide the document that shows the exporter or destroyer here in 123 waived the right to claim drawback and assigned that right to claim the drawback to the importer. So as long as that criteria is met, then we're fine. Of course, we have to keep in mind what type of drawback we have. If we're talking about unused merchandise drawback, because here we have the evidence, shoes were not used, right? Yeah, they were not used. So we have unused merchandise direct identification. There was no substitution going on. So we use second column, which is same as this one, right? So there still must be evidence. So this guy has to provide to this guy the waiver and assignment. Waiver plus assignment. So looking back at the answer choice, certification from the exporter waiving the right to claim drawback. So exporter and waiver are the buzzwords here, right? Here, the kind of combined waiver and assignment at the one close. Certificate of manufacture from the exporter. Certificate of manufacture and delivery, but that would be the person in the United States, right? So A is incorrect. Letter of credit from the exporter. Letter of credit is kind of like insurance instrument, which hedges, which is acts like a hedge in international trade from various parties involved from being screwed, because letter of credit usually issued by the bank, and there is an issuing bank, there is a receiving bank, and they only release money once there is evidence of presentation of the original to the to the title of the good. So it's the international international instrument related to the export and import. It's not related to the chain chain of title within the United States. Remember, the chain of custody is for the geographical period within the United States, and by that I mean customs territory of the United States. Notice of intent to export from the exporter. That's part of the requirement which A123 must provide as a part of its criteria, so customs can physically look that the stuff that are going out is in fact the stuff that the exporter is claiming. But this is not related to ABC and 123 relationship, so C is incorrect. Certificate of delivery from the exporter. Certificate of delivery from the exporter is established. The certificate of delivery establishes the chain, right? But see, here is the thing. Certificate of delivery. If you go to the definition, it is the instrument which summarizes the information which is contained in the document, right? It summarizes the assignment and drawback, right? So it's a certificate of delivery, right? Is transfer from one party to another of imported in the merchandise. So the certificate of delivery would be meaningful for these purposes, because if this party is worth to get the claim on the imported merchandise, ABC would have to provide to 123 the certificate of delivery. But here the question is goes in the opposite direction, which makes the certificate of delivery here an incorrect answer choice. So E is correct answer choice in this particular situation. All right, one more. The blank shall be entitled to claim drawback unless this party by means of certification assigns the right to claim drawback to an intermediate party in the following scenario. So okay, so let's take a look at the scenario here. So you have company Alpha that imports CBP duty assessed graphite from a seller MNO in Australia. So we have Australia and we have United States, and we have MNO, and we have Alpha, right? So Alpha issues a certificate of delivery to company B. So we have B here. So certificate of delivery. Company B uses all of the imported graphite to manufacture pencils. So it's manufacturing pencils and issues a certificate of manufacture and delivery to company D. So company B, manufacturer. So we are talking about the manufacturing direct identification drawback so far. So this is just a reseller. This is graphite. We're talking about the lead, right? The pencil lead, graphite core, manufacturer. All right, let's see. So company D, so to company D, right? Company D is the exporter. So company D, exporter. So the buzzword here is D is automatically eligible as long as they have those chain of custody documents that they are able to demonstrate that from the time it comes to the United States, they are able to demonstrate all those chains of custody which took place. So, but that is a default party. All other parties involved, they have to get assignment rights. They have the company D has to give them the right to claim drawback. So going back to the blank, let's take a look. The blank shall be entitled to claim drawback unless this party by means certification assignment. So in other words, what the customs examiners are saying is who is the default party to get this stuff. So default party based on a chart of direct manufacturing drawback, direct or substitution, is the exporter, right? And the exporter here is the company D. So the company D would be automatically entitled to claim that drawback. Here, the exporter or the company D is the correct answer choice. So C is the right answer for this particular question. All right, next one. So you can see by number of examples that customs really would like to see that examinees are aware of who is entitled and who is not entitled to claim the drawback. So next, which party has the right to claim drawback under the provision of direct identification drawback, right? So here we have direct identification drawback. Well, did they say manufacturing or not? I don't think so. So direct identification can apply to two scenarios, right? It can be either manufacturing or it can be unused merchandise. And it can either imply, here's the picture. It's before we even dive into this, we know that it's direct identification. And if this can imply manufacturing, or it can apply unused merchandise. Further, this is one criteria. Number two criteria, it can also imply that the product is either destroyed or exported. So it can be either or. As we go through these elements, right, we know that if those elements fit, then we have a right answer. And it can be a combination of those elements. But in order to analyze, we have to have this kind of mental picture. Or if you're out there, it makes it easier. You can write it out as you're going through the analysis of this particular question.